It's the summer of 1986, latter part of July, and we're preparing to do another of what we've come to know as Reflections in Time. And today we're going to do the Reflections in the Time of Harry Duncan, who just retired here in 1986 from our university as a professor in our Fine Arts College. And more particularly, we're having our taping session in what I feel is a very interesting place. For many years, I used to look at this, I think it was the Milder home, right, as it was being built here west of our University of Omaha campus. It looked like a Japanese pagoda or something rising out of the woods. Well, eventually, of course, in the history of our university, it became part of the university, and more particularly, the building became the home of the Fine Arts School and then college. And what we are in today is in the basement of this home, this college. And in interesting fashion, it's not just a basement at all. It's the home of something that I rather imagine many of you have never seen or heard much about. And that's what we call our Fine Arts Press area. And the man who's been running that, who initiated, I think, just got things rolling and who's been involved with it for so long, is going to tell us about it, and himself, Harry Duncan. Harry, it's nice to have you this nice July afternoon to visit a little bit about things.
I came to the university in the fall of 1972.
Okay, that's great, Harry, but I want to leap back in time now and pick your memory, because I think it's so interesting to learn about people's roots and where they came from and how they happened to be in what I think is a very interesting kind of work and art form that you're in. Where did you hail from, Harry?
Well, I was born in Keokuk, Iowa.
Oh, not too far away.
And graduated from high school there, and then graduated from Grinnell College.
Fine school.
And I was all set to become an English professor.
Oh, were you?
Had a graduate assistantship at Duke University, and that spring, I was to go to Duke, I read in Poetry Magazine of a school in Cummington, Massachusetts, which is in the mountains, a school of the arts, mm-hmm, and they were offering scholarships for students. And so I applied, and I got it. So on my way to Duke, I spent the summer in Cummington, Massachusetts. Well, in that school, they had a Washington-type press like these, and a little type, and nobody was paying much attention to them. But I got interested and started to fool around, mm-hmm, and did some atrociously designed, ignorantly put together pieces. But I got the bug.
Uh-huh.
Well, I then went to Duke. The next summer, I went back to Cummington, and this time we became a little more ambitious. And some of the students and I stayed after the session was over and cooked for ourselves and printed a pamphlet of student work, a couple of prints and poems and a story,
mm-hmm,
called it From This Hill. We got it done. It's a very rare item now, because I don't think any of us failed to realize that it was just not very good craftsmanship or workmanship or design. And it was an ugly thing. And so most of those copies were burned because we were ashamed. We did a second From This Hill the next summer, and that was somewhat better. We were proud enough so that we didn't destroy them.
Now you're really getting in line,
but,
huh?
Yeah. I had been bitten by the type lice and was very much interested in becoming a printer, in doing it by hand, mm-hmm. in the old way, because I thought that was the best way to do it.
Now, at this time,
I still think maybe it's true.
Uh-huh. Now, at that time, though, at the time you were beginning to get the feel and the enjoyment, excitement of hand typesetting and so on, were things rather modern by today's standards? Were they big presses, electronically run, and all that sort of thing?
That was another world.
What year was this about, Harry?
This must have been about 1940.
Mm-hmm.
And the electronic revolution was beginning to take over the industry. Offset was becoming the dominant way of printing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There was not yet the computer and that kind of typesetting, but there was the photocomposer already. All that equipment was just terribly expensive and out of sight. Besides, I was not interested in commercial printing. I was interested to work by hand to try to get things as perfect as I could. And the automatic machines tend to dictate what you're going to do. You really, to make them work well, you have to let them
take over,
tell you what you're going to do.
Uh-huh.
And hand type, and the old hand methods, which is what Gutenberg invented, is different because there's a lot of room for expansion and so on.
Oh, sure.
I had finished my master's thesis.
I was wondering what you were doing at this time. You were still going to school in English, that sort of thing?
Right. Okay. And I wrote a thesis on Jared Manley Hopkins and passed my examinations. And all except one, I overslept the exam in graduate French. It didn't scare me because I'd had a lot of French in college and could read it perfectly well. But I did oversleep, and they were very kind. They said if I wanted the master's degree, I should come back the next time that exam was given and take it. I never did return. Because by that time, I thought that English departments were a racket. That was partly my experience as a graduate assistant at Duke.
Why did you think that, Harry? That's interesting.
I was teaching something called remedial English.
Yeah.
And those Carolina boys would come down from the mountains with their colorful speech, using ain't correctly, you know, and so on. And I had to wash that color out of their speech and introduce normal academic English.
That sounds like an impossible task.
I didn't like that job. Although I was rather good at it, and I was offered, I could have been the English coach or something for the football team, which was Rose Bowl team at that time. But I didn't like it. And besides, the Cummington experience made me know that I wanted to be a printer, not an English professor.
Now that's interesting.
So I foolishly never returned to take that exam, never have had a master's degree. I've never had any cause to regret it. I'm amazed how loose the requirements in academe are about these things. But actually, I think maybe it's an advantage that I don't have an advanced degree. I don't know. Anyhow, I don't think I've ever suffered from it.
No. You got this bug merely by going to school in Pennsylvania and happening to...
No, Massachusetts.
Massachusetts, rather, and having to run on some equipment that was sort of sitting around.
Right. And that fall, we did a book of whaling letters.
Now, is this the fall after you just didn't take the French exam?
After I... goofed that.
Uh-huh.
We printed a book. It was whaling letters, which the ancestors of one of the students had found in her attic. And they were very interesting. They were in the 1860s, and they were from a whaler. They had relevance to Moby Dick and so on. We dampened the paper in the old way for printing that book, and we had it hardbound, and we decided on an imprint, the Cummington Press, which we put at the foot of the title page. And the results were enough improved to encourage us.
Are you still using that old equipment that you started with?
Oh, yes.
You found?
Oh, yes.
No change in equipment yet?
No change in equipment.
Uh-huh.
Then I was aided and abetted in all of this by the director of the school, who was named Catherine Frazier. She was a retired concert harpist, and she was a real live wire.
Was this a school of the arts, General?
Yes, but she was one of the best teachers of anything that I've ever had. She was wonderful, and she herself was very interested in this. Learned to set type and so on, even though she was already ill with cancer and didn't expect to live very long. Well, she sold her harp, her concert harp, in order to buy us a little treadle press like that one.
Oh, we'll take a look at that.
Because we thought that could be worked by one man alone, and that it would be, and was a little speedier and would help things. Well, it was too small for bookwork, and I broke it in the process, trying to load too much on it. The next winter.
Well, now, wait a minute, Harry.
Yeah.
What were you doing all this time? Was this your way of life? Did you have another job?
No, no. One winter, I went to the Neighborhood Playhouse School of the Theater in New York because Catherine Frazier had appointed me as drama teacher in Cummington School. And I went there to prepare for that. That was a marvelous experience.
Mm-hmm.
I was living in New York on $50 a month, which my father sent me. And you know, New York at that time, the museums had no fee. The subway fare was 15 cents.
Yeah.
And so I was able to get by. And, well, that was a marvelous winter. I had Martha Graham for a teacher and Sandy Meisner.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next winter, I taught at an experimental progressive school called Manumit School, which was then located in Pawling, New York. And I had 6 weeks of apprenticeship with a man called Edmund B. Thompson, who ran the Hawthorne Press in a little Connecticut town.
Uh-huh.
And the reason the apprenticeship was so short, only 6 weeks, was because Ned's conscience began to bother him about the war effort. And so he stopped printing and went to Washington and became something to do with maps and so on, and never printed a book again, which is terrible. He was a very good printer.
But you, now all of what you had done thus far in the early 40s at theater school, working with the encouragement of this lady back at the school in Massachusetts, were you just self-taught? Did anyone say, Harry, here's how to do it, or what?
We were perfectly aware that to teach yourself this technique was sort of like reinventing the wheel, because it had developed, you know, from the time of Gutenberg for 500 years. People learned little rules of thumb, tricks of the trade, which we had to learn all by ourselves. A very inefficient way. So it was trial and error that taught us, mostly error, and it's not the way to learn. We looked all over the country to find somebody we could learn hand printing from.
I was wondering if there
was not being done. now, that we could discover anywhere.
In that time, it wasn't too many years since hand printing had been used fairly actively, right?
Yes. And, of course, not only hand printing, but letterpress was on the way out. Mm-hmm. Ned set all his type by hand, but he printed his books on a Colt's Armory press, which was power.
Oh, so it was power-driven.
Power-driven.
But in the pure art form, you do everything by hand.
That's right, and it's your muscles.
Well, so the years as you began here, you really trundled along, trial and error, trying to learn.
Right.
But you had the bug. And
I had the bug.
And you kept the disease all your life, haven't you?
Yeah. It was a terrible disappointment when a book would come back from the bindery, and I'd examine it and see all the things that could have been better. And so that kind of learning is a very painful process. Would have been much better to become an apprenticeship to a good hand pressman and learn the rules right.
But there wasn't an opportunity to do that, really?
There was no opportunity. That scene has changed a lot. There are now many universities that have hand presses. Fine presses, and two places, the University of Alabama and Mills College in California, have graduate programs in it.
Really? So it really has come on
it's
in the last
really,
30 years.
It's really caught on.
It seems to me, from what you've been telling us so far in our reflections on your time here, is that what you did was really sort of rekindle an art form there in the 1940s, helped to keep it alive, really. And help it grow.
Well, that sounds vainglorious to say, but at Cummington we were really about the only place at the time doing that and attaching it to publishing new literature.
Mm-hmm.
That came about also through the influence of the school, because the school had a kind of early form of the Writers' Conference, and some of the good writers came for a week each summer and taught the writers' courses, and they included some very good men, Allen Tate, R.P. Blackmore, Delmore Schwartz, Marion Moore, to name only a few. This gave the press a direction for publishing, and we decided that we wanted to do works of new literature and not continue with Americana like the Whaling Letters or other things. We were doing occasional printing for the school, printing the concert programs and so on. But that was not of enough of a motive.
No.
And it's very difficult to be a job printer when you're working entirely by hand in our age. You can't make a living, really. Although we did, I'll get into that later, we did make a living for a while doing that.
So really you were doing a number of things for the school and then for new writers.
Right. And we got a manuscript by R.P. Blackmer, a manuscript of poems, and through the influence of another student named Samuel French Morse, we got a long poem by Wallace Stevens called Notes Toward a Supreme Fiction to print, and that really got us going, gave us tremendous momentum and drive.
Did it go well, you mean?
Yes, and we also got a manuscript from Allen Tate. The reason we could do this at that time is because the New York publishers, because of the war difficulties and so on, were neglecting books of poetry.
We're in the early 40s now, aren't we?
Right. And so we got Allen Tate's manuscript had been I think rejected by somebody. probably not just because of war shortages.
Mm-hmm.
It was thought that the poems, which are very much about contemporary American life, were a little bit too subversive, perhaps. Anyway, it was a great manuscript. And to work on a new poem, setting it up slowly, letter by letter, in the stick, and then taking a proof of it, is the most exacting and deep kind of reading. The mechanics of setting the type can be become fairly automatic. You don't have to think much about that. But the poem itself can fill your mind. And so it becomes a very contemplative, rich reading experience. And it's still one that I enjoy more than almost anything.
Don't you think what you've said so far, Harry, suggests to me that your English background, which is sort of as a teaching possibility, look down your nose at, is really holding you in good stead in the work that you've been doing.
Well, I had some marvelous teachers at Duke.
Yeah.
Even the man who directed my remedial English, of course, was a very nice man. But I did want to work with my hands.
Mm-hmm.
And doing more with them than grading papers, I wanted to make something with them.
Oh, yeah.
The next year, we discovered that there was living in Cummington Village, where there was a hostel for German refugees, a man named Gustav Wolf, who was from Karlsruhe, Germany, and who, before his exile, had been an artist, and wood engraving had been his specialty.
Oh.
And so Catherine Fraser and I worked out the idea of having Gustav Wolf and his wife come up to the press, and we were to do a fancy edition of the Book of Job with wood engravings by him and a good essay on the Book of Job by Alfred Young Fisher, who was a poet from Northampton who had been in the writer's workshop at the school.
At the school, yes, I see.
And a trustee of the school very kindly gave the money, and Gus and his wife, Lola, moved up, and we stayed in the women's dormitory, which is the only building that had a furnace in it. And we turned the kitchen there, which was enormous, the main kitchen of the school, into a press room, and started to print the Book of Job. The winter was, even though it was mild, it was very hard to get that temperature in that house above 60 degrees.
And you need warmer weather for that, don't
the
you?
The furnace had been made for the cooler spring and fall days, not for the severe winters that you have in the Berkshires. But we did get the book done. By the spring, when it was finished printing and was off to be bound, we were strapped. We had exhausted all the monies that had been given and had to let Gus and Lola go. And at that time, the United States government decided to make a propaganda movie based on Gus's story, except fancied up and given a happy ending.
Mm.
And so they came up and invaded our press room and the house and so on with all their, you know how elaborate filming was in those days,
my.
The huge cables and everything. And the movie, The Cummington Story, was a success. Aaron Copland wrote the music for it, and it was a prestigious movie. To me, it was just a lie, because supposedly this exile from Germany had broken through and was accepted as an artist in America, and was everything was hunky-dory.
And that wasn't the case.
And that was not the case. His wife finally found a job as a house mother at one of the prep schools near Cummington. So I didn't like that feature of it, that it was a lie.
Was there any financial reward for them in using this story of their lives?
No, none. You know how, just as little as I'm getting for this number, Paul.
Nothing.
Yes. And during that winter, when we were so cold in the house, a young GI named Paul Williams came up and knocked at the door one winter's night. And so we put him up, and he was terrifically interested in everything. And he got out of the service that spring and decided to come up and risk his lot. And even though we were strapped, we had no money after we paid for the binding of, he agreed to stay with me and try to make a go of it. And we had very interesting manuscripts on hand. We had Robert Lowell's first book called Land of Unlikeness, for which Gustav Wolf did a frontispiece wood engraving. And we had manuscript by William Carlos Williams called The Wedge. And we had a second manuscript of Wallace Stevens. And we had Allen Tate's translation of the Perigillium Veneris, the Vigil of Venus.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very good things to work on.
Oh, yes.
And that gave us the incentive to continue. And so Paul and I decided to stay the next winter. And we printed Land of Unlikeness on that little treadle press.
How did you manage for money?
We had a small backlog of books, and when the Book of Job went on the market, it was a success to steam. It didn't sell like hotcakes, but it did place among the 50 books of the year, a contest of the American Institute of Graphic Arts.
Oh.
So it had some prestige.
Yes, indeed.
And that, of course, was encouraging as well.
Really?
So we stayed that winter, and it was an historic winter because they had one of the greatest blizzards ever. The blizzard hit just when we were out of coal for the furnace. And we had a decision to make whether to try to stay on under these adverse circumstances or not. The drifts, the snow drifts in the roads were 20 feet high. The roads were impassable for weeks. And nevertheless, we decided to stay in the house. We could shut off the water and still get water by letting the spring water run into the sink constantly. And we decided we were going to cut wood for the kitchen range. And so we stayed on that winter, and we got a lot of work done. We didn't freeze to death, even though we had to spend so much time keeping alive.
Oh, yeah.
We had to bring in mail, groceries, and so on skis.
Now, there were just the two of you?
Just the two of us. And we managed it. It was
Well, that was
really,
a historic
really
winter.
A wonderful winter for me, because I not only learned more about printing, I learned something about self-reliance in the Thoreau way. So we kept, Paul Williams stayed, and we kept going until 1952, about.
So this went on for a number of years then.
Yes, the school was reopened. Catherine Fraser had died of her cancer, and the school was reopened, however, after the war.
After the war,
And never did really make a success of it. It still runs under the name Cummington Community of the Arts, not as a school, but as a kind of artist colony where artists go to work and so on.
Yeah. All right.
Well, we decided that we'd better leave Cummington School in 1952.
You and Paul.
It seemed to be winding down, and the trustees were very generous. They gave us all of the printing equipment and all of the back stock of books that we had printed.
So everything you had to work with and did was yours?
Yes. And this was a major break in my life. And so my father had died and left me a small legacy, and I used it up to go to live in Italy for 9 months. And Paul worked as an artist in New York during that time. Paul had always attended to the illustration of the things we did, and I to the typesetting, and we printed them, of course, together. After I got back from Italy...
Wait a minute, I want to know what you did in Italy. Why did you go?
I lived mostly in Rome, which I really fell in love with. And my godfather, Allen Tate, was there. Well, it was a wonderful time. I didn't do any printing. I, like a fool, I didn't even go to see Hans Mardersteig at the Officine Bodoni in Verona. I was bashful about it. And I'd been doing this for so long, I did need a little break from it. So I just saw Italy. And
sounded like a marvelous time.
It was a marvelous time. After I got back, we decided to set up the press still in Massachusetts, because that's where we were oriented. And we didn't want to move to New York. Paul's experience there had not made setting a press up in New York City a very attractive prospect. We found an old Greek Revival house in a little town called Roe, Massachusetts, which is still in the Berkshires, almost into Vermont. And it was for sale for a very reasonable price, because it needed fixing. Well, we did make a living, kept our mortgage payments up. We did it not only by job printing, and the town fathers in Rome, the select men, were very kind to us and gave us all the public printing to do. We did a town report by hand with illustrations by Paul, and we did firemen's ball tickets, such things. And that helped. We also had commissions to do books from Chapin Library at Williams College and the Pierpont Morgan Library in New York, and a couple of others. But we didn't get any of our own things done to speak of. After 2 years, we'd only published 3 new works ourselves, 2 of which were pamphlets. And that did not seem to be pursuing the ideals that we looked toward.
No, no.
And in the summer of 1956, Paul Williams was killed in an automobile wreck.
That's right.
And about that time, a professor from the journalism school at the University of Iowa called me up and said that Carol Coleman, who was then heading the typographic laboratory there, was being kicked upstairs, and if I would be interested to come to Iowa to run that typographic laboratory and teach. And of course, in the circumstances, I did accept, loaded the enormous press and the type and all the equipment onto a trailer, and drove the car from Rome, Massachusetts to Iowa City.
All your worldly belongings.
And I couldn't go more than 30 miles an hour without the trailer, which it hadn't been well packed, swaying. So it took me a while.
Sounded like a rather precarious trip. Didn't lose anything.
And at Iowa, I taught courses in, well, the courses there were geared to the communications industry of the state, more or less. So I had to teach magazine production and advertising typography and a lot of things that didn't have to do with my chief interest, which was book typography by hand. Nevertheless, I found it very absorbing and the students very absorbing. The trouble was, I found it too absorbing, and my wife, who was one of my students in a course at Iowa, that's how I met her.
Is it?
And I had moved to West Branch, Iowa, which is a kind of bedroom town near Iowa City.
Mm-hmm.
Got a house there, and I had built a press room onto the house, moved my equipment in. Nevertheless, the job at the university took up so much of my time that I did not get very much printing done.
The press was just sitting
there. And the press a little bit, was on its last legs when a grant came through from the National Endowment for the Arts, and it came through for the next 2 years as well. And that helped a lot, got my attention redirected towards that.
Mm-hmm.
Also, even more important, I had two volunteer apprentices show up, and they asked to stay and study book typography with me there. And they were Juan Pasco, who has now set up his own press in Mexico, the only fine press in Mexico that I know of, and the other, Ashley Bullitt, who gave up printing when she met her present husband. They were such a good stimulus to me because they really valued what I wanted. They weren't looking for jobs in the communications industry or anything of that sort. Then in 1972, as I discovered only the other day, really, from Neil Shaver, Vic Blackwell,
mm-hmm,
was then interim chancellor, and he was at some kind of lunch meeting with Neil, and they happened to sit next to one another. Neil had been, although he was running the Shaver markets at that time, he'd always been very interested in printing, had got himself equipment, including a Washington-style hand press, type and so on, and he was then using it only to do the flyers and advertisements and so on for Shaver Markets.
Oh, is that right?
Nevertheless, he and Vic got to talking, and they said it would be a good thing to set up a fine arts press here at the university. And to that end, it was arranged that there be an exhibit of fine printing by me and two of my students, Doyle Moore and Kim Merker, both then from Iowa City. Doyle has since moved to the University of Illinois. Mm-hmm. And that exhibit was held in the gallery when it was over in Arts and Sciences Hall.
Now, you were still at Iowa at this time.
I was still in Iowa. Uh-huh. But for the opening, Kim and Doyle and I came over, and we met some of the powers that be, and Gaines.
Bill Gaines.
Bill Gaines. And I don't know who, we didn't meet Vic at that time, as I recall. Peter Hill, whom we stayed with. And we went to dinner with Bill Gaines and Neil Shaver, and out of that came an offer. It was first made to Kim Merker, who didn't accept it because he was just setting up the Windover Press at the University of Iowa.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was made to me, and I accepted like a shot because it involved an agreement that I would teach half time and the other half of my time would be spent printing and publishing.
But now
books.
You had an arrangement that you could live and enjoy both.
Yes. And so I accepted, and we came that year. At Peter's house, we played around with the idea for a name for the books that we were going to issue, and we thought that the university should have its own imprint.
Mm-hmm.
And we understood that a meat packing had been a chief industry in Omaha. We didn't know that it had been decentralized almost out of sight by then. But there was the name Abattoir, which just means slaughterhouse,
mm-hmm.
and we thought that that would be appropriate. And so we gave the name for the publisher of the books Abattoir Editions, and that's how the books that we do down here have been issued.
Is that right? That's interesting. Now,
the university kept its agreement, by
uh-huh,
the way.
Uh-huh.
I have, and they have also been more than kind to me in many other ways. So I've had wonderful support, even though my credit hour production never could be satisfactory. There are stations here for only 8 students to work at once.
You can't handle many students
and
at time.
And I offer 2 sections, and so does Bonnie now. Even so, that's only 16 students. That's hardly bread and butter for me. Nevertheless, I have never had any objection to that arrangement.
Marvelous. Now, in the course of a student's life here on campus who's interested in the work that's consumed much of your life, many courses did you began, though, offerings as far as courses went, didn't you, as you came here, I suppose?
Yes. When I first came, I was very ambitious. I knew that there was no adequate training for the publishing arts
mm-hmm.
in the Midwest, the whole Midwest. There still isn't, by the way.
Including the school that you came from.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Book publishing is a kind of 19th century do-it-yourself kind of thing where the girls come from Barnard and are hired into it, and the boys from, you know, it's an in-group northeastern establishment affair, which is very, very bad for a business to be in that state. It's important that some attention be given by universities to this discipline. When I first came, I was ambitious and I thought we could set things up. The facilities were all here, especially if we used what was in Lincoln as well, mm-hmm. The University of Nebraska Press. Well, when I got listed all of the courses I thought that such a student should have, because of prerequisite requirements and the stigma of crossing department lines in yeah. this university system, it would have taken a student 8 years. And so I gave up that idea. And so I offered a course called the hand-produced book, which is repeatable for credit and is in the fundamentals of setting type and printing by hand. Students who take it a second semester can do a more ambitious project. Mm-hmm. And I offered two seminars, one in the history of manuscript books and the other in the history of printing. And those were never great drawing cards. I deliberately made no prerequisites for any of these courses. They were open to anybody. Well, I thought that that would cover the fundamentals of the book arts mm-hmm. For students. I think maybe it does. Because some of my students have gone on to better things.
What sorts of things have they gone on to?
Well, Don Knepfler has set up his own press in his house.
Yeah.
And he was one of my very first students here. And Neil Shaver is now at the Yellow Barn Press, giving all of his time to printing books by hand.
Is he really?
And these are getting very favorably noticed. They are very creditable, and I'm proud of that. Some of my good students haven't done anything so obviously in the line of book arts, but I think probably what they learned has helped them in other ways.
No, I think, Harry, we've talked in such interesting fashion about all the years of interesting excitement that brought you here to our campus in the early 70s, and I think it's a marvelous thing that you did come and the things you've been doing. Now, that's what I want to get to next, what you've been doing. Very simply, for the tape, for the archives, for memory, just talk us through the very laborious process of this art form as you put a piece of work, a small book, anything together.
In my opinion, and it's not shared by all fine printers, the most important thing is the text. If I believe in the value of what I am printing, it contributes to the care and gives me a little bit of inspiration for the way I handle it.
The ultimate quality of the book can be up by that.
It gives me some insights that are beyond a mere mechanical planning mm-hmm. of the book.
Mm-hmm.
After a work has been found that you think is worth printing and that engages the deepest convictions of your taste, then I, at least, begin experimenting with typefaces which will seem appropriate for that book. And this is a process which is extremely synthetic. The typefaces have to be of a right size for the available papers, which also need to be in accord with the still subliminal idea of what the book should be.
Mm-hmm.
I think a craftsman really doesn't know what his work is going to be like finally until he's finished with it, because he's making constant changes and what he thinks of as improvements in it. So it's important not to be too stubbornly set about what you want ahead of time, so that the text and the type and the paper can speak to you and to one another and set up a kind of dialogue so that they work out a harmonious relationship.
Even if the paper is an important part of it.
Oh, yes, indeed. The paper.
The quality, the color.
Very
everything.
Important. And becoming a real problem because it's become so expensive to purchase a good handmade paper that it drives the price of the books up beyond what a common reader can afford, mm-hmm. I'm afraid.
So the paper is not just paper in the right hand, but it's handmade paper.
Handmade paper is the best for this process, and it's the best in an absolute way. It's apt to be stronger. You see, the fibers in hand paper making are shaken every which way, so that they overlap in all directions, so that it doesn't have any grain. Therefore, the handmade paper is stronger than machine made.
And easier to work with, I should imagine.
Well, not necessarily easier. That depends upon the sizing of the paper, the fibers it's made of, and so on.
Uh-huh.
And handmade paper can be very cussedly hard to print.
Oh, is that right?
But normally it is dampened before printing so that the fibers open and the size is softened and the ink penetrates. The type is set by hand in a stick, and this is to me the most delicious part of the book because I'm discovering the text as I'm setting it, and also discovering what works typographically and so on. And so composition to me is the most fun.
That's what you enjoy the most.
But I also like press work too.
Uh-huh.
After you get the type set and page proofs sent to the author and corrected, then you go to press and you... The book that I'm now doing, I'm printing on a Vandercook Universal Press. And however, the principle is the same.
Mm-hmm.
It's a cylinder press rather than a flatbed press like this.
I see.
And so you...
Reminds one of a mimeograph machine.
Right, right. Press work is a part of the process that is very difficult for me, and I really don't think I'm awfully good at it. It always is a pain in the neck, but I do like, I don't mean that I don't like it, I do. It's so conclusive, however,
mm-hmm.
when you take the print. It's different from setting the type because that always can be changed.
Changed, yeah.
But when you take that print, there any mistake lies in history forever because you can't take it back.
Now, do you ever get to that stage and find, this just isn't right, and then you have to start all over again?
Yes. That's a lucky if you can do that. But the terrible thing is to have a book come back from the bindery and only then see some flaw that you had missed before. And then it works on your conscience.
But isn't imperfection, which is a part of all of us, a normal part of hand work, Harry?
Yes, it is a normal part of hand work, and sufficient to the day is the evil thereof.
Yes.
But part of the quality of craftsmanship is the constant fight to overcome these imperfections.
So that's the goal.
One never can.
No.
Entirely.
Have you ever done something that was you felt exactly right without anything of consequence being an error?
I can't say that I've ever enjoyed that much vanity. But there are some things that don't strike me as obviously flawed. Some things are less obviously flawed than others.
On through the process.
And, you know, even when this book comes back from the bindery and you spot this, you think, oh, you can start another book and now it's going to be better and you can avoid these.
There's always tomorrow.
Yeah, but there's always something that creeps in.
Yeah. That's an interesting description of it. And while we've been talking about it, now our producer will help Mark will lay some things in here to show these things. Another thing I wanted to spend a little time with you on, because you spent the years since 1972 to 86 as a hardworking member of our faculty and staff with the two jobs that you've been really working at, and I should imagine often night and day. You came to the university, as you told me a little while ago, you just jumped at the chance to come. It seemed like an opportunity that you wanted to take a hold of. So you and your good wife moved over here. Have you been happy?
Oh, yes, I have been. For the most part, you know, there are always a few little thorns in one side.
But the job generally has been what you expected it could be?
Well, it was an interesting and challenging job because I didn't know what to expect. I don't think the university knew what to expect.
No, we were going into new territory, weren't
we? I'm sure my deans all were didn't quite know what to do with me because I didn't fit very well into the prescribed forms. But they've all been good to me, nevertheless.
Speaking of that, Harry, a university is not only press and ink, it's mainly people. Now test your memory a little. Who are some of the people that stand out in your memory who have been good to you and with you and that stand out in your work and your fellowship with the university community here?
Well, my present dean is a princely man who, when I was prevented from putting my press equipment in my attic on my retirement, which is what I had first intended to do, some well-wisher put a little seed of doubt in my head about whether the attic floor was strong enough to hold it. And a little seed of doubt can do terrible damage.
Oh, indeed so.
And so I was in a quandary about this, and he very munificently offered to remodel this garage in the back into a kind of emeritus press room.
So you're going
and
to have
he
your
even place. Introduced some outside windows there so that I have some daylight, which is a great benefit to me.
Well, that sounds like a marvelous future. Anyone else that stands out along with your current dean?
A great friend was Ralph Wardle.
Oh, yes.
And he provided me a kind of model for retirement. He mandatorily was dismissed at the age of 65, so that the university lost what are probably Ralph's five best years, which he spent teaching at Creighton. And now he is teaching at his old prep school.
Back in Massachusetts.
In Massachusetts.
Right.
And he was a great friend. We never had any direct official connections in the university. But is certainly someone that whom I remember.
Uh-huh.
I have got along with all my deans. And maybe that's a scandalous thing, because some of them have been summarily dismissed.
Yes, but you got along with all of them.
Yeah, even the illiterate ones.
Now, we let that one pass. Now, in summation, we have a couple minutes left on our tape. What has been the greatest source of personal satisfaction in these many years you devoted to hard, laborious work in this art form?
I think the greatest satisfaction in the sense of zestful interest in the thing is starting that new book, which is going to avoid the mistakes that have been made in the past and be a beautiful work of art. I think that's the greatest thing about it.
Harry, I can't tell you how interesting and exciting it's been to sit and visit with you and pick your brain about the past and the present and even a little look at the emeritus future room we're going to have here at the university for some of the work that you have set up and begun so well and which is going to be carried on in years to come. I thank you sincerely for joining me.
Thank you, Paul.
This Reflections in Time has been done in the Fine Arts Press area of our UNO Fine Arts building with Professor Harry Duncan, now retired. The time is the summer now. We're into the summer of 1986.